This is DNA. But how do we know what it looks like? Well, in 1909, it was discovered that DNA was made up of these small building blocks called nucleotides. These nucleotides are made of three parts: a sugar with 5 carbons, a negatively charged phosphate group, and something that has a lot of nitrogens, appropriately named nitrogenous bases. Notice how the sugars and phosphate groups are identical in the 4 different nucleotides, but the nitrogenous bases are unique. The names of the nitrogenous bases are adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. So okay, these are the building blocks of DNA, but how do we actually put these building blocks together? At the start, many scientists thought that they combined like this, with 4 nucleotides making up one DNA. They called this the Tetranucleotide Hypothesis, with tetra meaning 4, kind of like Tetris. However, this wasn't correct. It wasn't until 1953, when Watson and Crick, using the incredibly important data from Rosalind Franklin, figured out how the building blocks were put together. Take a look. Their model was beautiful, and it turned out to be absolutely correct. Now I want you to pay attention to a couple of DNA's features. First, notice how the spaces between the helix aren't all the same size. This groove is larger than this one, so they're respectively called the major groove and minor groove. Because the major groove is larger, it's more susceptible for things to attach or bind to it, which is something we'll come back to in the next few videos. Now, let's unwind the helix and look more closely. Remember that DNA actually isn't flat, but looking at it this way will help us analyze DNA better. Notice how DNA is made of 2 strands. Each strand consists of many nucleotides and is therefore called a polynucleotide strand. The nucleotides combine together by forming covalent bonds between the phosphate group of one nucleotide and the sugar of the next nucleotide, so these bonds are appropriately called phosphodiester bonds. And notice that the 2 strands interact with each other as well. The nitrogenous bases in each strand face each other and form hydrogen bonds across. Note that A always pairs with T, and C always pairs with G. Something else to keep in mind is that hydrogen bonds are much weaker than covalent bonds, so while it wouldn't be difficult to separate the 2 strands, it'd be much harder to break the strands themselves. Thus, these 2 strands are often called the backbone of DNA. And since they consist of the sugar and phosphate components of nucleotides, they're more specifically called the sugar-phosphate backbone. And one more thing, the 2 strands appear to be parallel, but if you look at the individual nucleotides, you'll notice that they face opposite directions in each strand. You could say that the 2 strands are antiparallel, and as you'll see in the next few videos, this bidirectionality is really important. So scientists needed a way to label which direction is which. They could have gone with west and east or left and right, but instead, scientists went with something more specific. Remember how I said that the sugar in each molecule has 5 carbons? Well, scientists realized that they could give each of these carbons a number, with the number 1 carbon, or 1 prime carbon, being attached to the nitrogenous base, and the number 5 carbon, or 5 prime carbon, being attached to the phosphate. And looking at these numbers, we can see a difference between the 2 strands. In this strand, the 5 prime carbon is on the left side, and the 3 prime carbon is on the other side, and on the other strand, the opposite is true. Thus, each direction of DNA is labeled either 5 prime or 3 prime. But as beautiful as this structure is, there's still one question that needs to be answered.